Jesus.
Radiant team ban. Team Liquid's turn to ban. Seconds remaining. Radiant team pick.
Invoker.
Team Liquid's turn to pick. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Dusker.
Team Liquid's turn to pick.
Welcome back, everybody, to We Play. Welcome back, everybody, to We Play. We're finally here with Team Liquid versus Team Cookies. It took a really long time to start for whatever reason, but hey, we're finally in our game. Of course, it's myself, Capitalist, joined by Blaze once again. Blaze, I don't know how much you've seen of Cookies, but they're, in my opinion, a team that has a lot of potential talent. I mean, you've got names like Pablo, who you've seen on for a little while, Steph Style, and E-Skills, who have been together for quite some time, but I've also been particularly impressed with Kezu and his improvement as an individual player over the last, like, 3 or 4 months.
Definitely. I mean, he's only been on the team for he's been able to contribute a lot for an extended period of time. The Swedes in general, like, they always show potential. I still think that they have some room to grow, but obviously switching out their most recent carry position with Flens has been bringing them some success here and there. They've taken some good wins, so I'm looking forward to seeing where this team really finds themselves. I'm looking at their drafts, and there's some very clear themes here of heroes that they find very valuable, and it happens to coincide very well with the 6.86 metagame. Fact is, in the first phase, they're always going to make sure that they can grab at least one, if not two, of the heroes between Invoker, Earth Spirit, and Chen. And since, of course, the Earth Spirit is so valuable in Team Liquid's hands, they take that out, they pick up the Invoker, and they're off to a pretty good start. Now, they've got the Void, they've got a pretty good, well-rounded thing, and I just kind of feel like securing these core pickups, securing the mid and the offlane, is a pretty high priority for both sides. I mean, obviously, Fata's really well known. Mind Control plays Nature's Prophet so frequently and so effectively, it creates a lot of opportunities. But overall, I think Cookies have a very interesting style they bring to the game, because they're not afraid of drafting melee carries to go with the Void. Like, they'll pick up an Ursa or a Slark with this and be perfectly fine with it. They are happy to play around the Chronosphere, use it mostly to disable the back lines, and then just get tons of damage on the front. So it's actually pretty interesting what they're bringing. It's definitely something a little bit different, though obviously the picks are common these days. I want to note also that Eskil, playing the Invoker here, he has played so much Invoker. 46 officials this month on Invoker with a 61% win rate. I mean, this guy, he's the characteristic dirty Invoker picker.
Yeah, he definitely is. I've known that guy for quite some time now, and I would say he's a pretty decent mid, but I don't think he's necessarily going to be beating out Fata. Maybe with this matchup, the Invoker might actually lend himself to beating Puck, but then again, now we have a Lycan, where Lyle comes into play. We already had Nature's Prophet potentially porting in. That's going to be another factor that he's going to have to keep in mind playing that Invoker. Now, Kukiz do have a good combination with the Faceless Void, though, between the Invoker and the Disruptor. And honestly, Disruptor's not a bad controlling hero versus Lycan either. So it's kind of interesting, Team Liquid kind of disregarding those second and third pick and still picking Lycan simply because it synergizes so well with their lineup.
Yeah, they just really want to emphasize the early push. The howl damage is actually going to be a big deal for the Puck. The one thing that Puck lacks in the matchup is really damage early other than the Null Talisman. So getting that extra little bit of attack damage, I think, will give Fata the edge in that matchup. And then, of course, they're going to be able to kind of really build momentum early. A lot of Tier 1 tower kills. And we're not going to be seeing, like, a Lich for Ice Armor or a Treant Protector for Living Armor. We're just going to be seeing a Wyvern, which doesn't really do much in terms of defending towers that are, especially in the offlane. Like, Wyvern and Disruptor are very much glued to their safe lane. Void is a hero that doesn't defend his offlane tower whatsoever. So I feel like Team Liquid have already guaranteed themselves at least one tower, if not a second one, once they make their first rotation. So Liquid already with like a 2-tower advantage in my mind by 15 minutes. So that Kukiz are going to have to find a kind of turtle potential and comeback potential in the sense that they're going to be behind in net worth. They're going to have to make up for it in terms of execution when they bring their cooldowns into play. The Wyvern brings some interesting possibilities with, of course, the ability to lock in the Lycan after he's shapeshifted, or just anybody that's vulnerable to the Lycan can be auto-attacked down. For example, if you hit it on the Puck at long range and you have a couple heroes next to him, that Puck's not going to last too long. But it really comes down to execution. It comes down to positioning, and it comes down to making sure these ultimates connect, because Kukiz start really failing to hit their big disabling abilities. Where's their damage coming from? The Invoker is the only one putting out damage right now.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think they need to really round up their lineup when it comes to big damage-dealing carries?
I mean, anything early game, like Ember, like usually you look to like an Ember Spirit here, but honestly, that's way too greedy. That's something that doesn't come online fast enough. So even while I'm not the biggest fan of Juggernaut and Faceless Void, I think that early game damage is considerable. I think that that works really well with the Wyvern, so I think Juggernaut could be quite promising. Beyond that, I mean, there's a few, like they, like I said, they picked up Ursa recently, and that's pretty interesting as far as a possibility, but. It really comes down to getting something that can bring a lot to the table as soon as possible. And the characteristic tempo carry is still the gyrocopter or the jug with the gyro band out.
Yeah, another one of those heroes that would have gone quite well with this lineup was the Draw Ranger, which Team Liquid did ban away. It would have actually offset the Howl advantage that Puck is going to be getting, as well as potentially that Furion roaming factor, and probably given that mid lane back to the advantage of the Invoker. But I'm with you on the Juggernaut. I think that sounds like one of the like most reasonable. Like it's either something like that's going to be really standard and just kind of fits everything, which is Juggernaut, or it's going to be something that's like really out there and rather unique. Okay, they do go for the Ember Spirit. You said it was greedy. I kind of agree with you. The Puck is going to be one of the biggest issues here for Flens as the Ember Spirit because of that blink silence is just so powerful versus the Ember. And even if you do try and build against it, say a Manta style being picked up, that's going to significantly delay your Battle Fury, which just leaves you really exposed to those mid-game pushes that we're talking about. Profit.
If Kukiz can handle the early game well enough, if they can kind of cut their losses on a few engagements, seed a few objectives, don't contest too heavily, just kind of build themselves up, get Kezio Blink Dagger, get Invoker, his Midas progression, and get, most importantly, first and foremost, Ember that Battle Fury, and they don't lose a Tier 3 tower by that point, I think that Kukiz definitely have the potential to bring it back, but just from this draft alone, they're already kind of on the back foot. Team Liquid, they're going to take tower. They're going to look for a lot of kills, and their first big thing is going to be their number one Roche, whether it comes at it like as early as 10 minutes, or they kind of push it back a little bit, focus on towers, and only take it at like 17, 18 minutes. Either way, Roche number one is going to be Liquid's ticket to the high ground, and that's going to be the time where they're at the strongest, when the Ember is, I wouldn't say useless without a Battle Fury, but certainly less effective in that context.
Yeah, and even if we do see the kind of early rush to a Battle Fury and he gets it at decent timing, it's still probably not going to be enough damage by itself to keep Liquid out of their base, right? You really need the Battle Fury plus the Crystallis Daedalus, where you can really see Cookies finally being in a more dominant position in this game, where they're actually the ones controlling, or at least holding their ground well enough that they can push it late. But as you said, it all comes down to the laning phase, and it should be pretty normal defensive tri lane for Cookies as well as Team Liquid. One of the big differentiators, though, is going to be the fact that the mid matchup, which is normally favorable to the Invoker, has a lot of extenuating factors here. Both the Tusk as well as the Furion are going to be roaming into that mid lane, as well as that global presence of the Howl. I can't really see the Invoker doing well in this sort of situation, knowing that Liquid are going to be putting so much pressure on him.
Damn, and there's just so much comfort for Liquid's lineup overall. Like, if you look at it, you've got Fata Puck, which is a classic, Mind Control, Nature's Prophet, which he's played more than anything else this patch, or at least on the more recent games. Jerex, if it's not Earth Spirit, it's going to be the Tusk. Unless you're banning both of them, it's really hard to avoid that. And then Matoma Man, I'm sure he can manage well enough on the Lycanthrope too. It's not the most common pick for anyone, but it's also not the most complex. Like, as long as you got your basic farming patterns down, you should be able to stuff done. And yeah, he's going to have a pretty safe lane. I mean, Kezu will try to do some action up top, but not really easy for a Void to get involved at all. And yeah, we'll have to see. Of course, if the Ember Spirit gets online quickly, if maybe they're able to find a quick pick on the Nature's Prophet, who is vulnerable, even with the boots, and I could see some momentum going the way of Kiss, but they're going to need everything they can get in the first 10 to 20 minutes.
Alright, so we are going to be starting off with some early action here. Liquid are going to go for a 4-man smoke into the Tusk Snowball. See if they can get a quick first blood and establish run control right off the bat. They've got the Furion doing its typical thing, which is scouting with the Treants. So this may put Cookies at like a little bit of ease, which obviously they should not be. Yeah, it's going to be Steph style here. The Snowball is...
Oh,
no, it's
going to
be Ice Shard instead.
Oh.
Jerex must not have been in range. And now Kezu's going to be obviously a little bit caught. He still has a time lock, though. And will be able to get himself away. Pablo got some decent damage out, but now it's going to be Cookies' time to be able to turn this thing around. They get a good chains off onto two. They're going to look for Kuro first as the first blood. He should be quickly going down. That's going to be one. Can they get two? Pablo's already low. Fana might try and jump for him. He is going to go for it, but he's only going to be able to get one of those right clicks. And now they might be able to pick up the bounty rune. Yeah, Jerex managed to steal that one. That could be well worth his life potentially, but it is going to cost him big time. Fauna's going to return back to that mid lane, but he's already at half HP, and Steph Styles looking to maybe push it a little bit more. So though, they got the bounty rune for Kezu, so it was a split plus first blood and second blood going to Cookies. A good start for them, which is pretty surprising given the nature of the 4-man snowball plus Tusk. Oftentimes that kind of combination guarantees first bloods.
Absolutely. I mean, it's so much more effective when you can just kind of get that quick pick very early on. And I think he was in snowball range, which is why it was so surprising, but he didn't have it skilled up, so you can't highlight, you can't be sure. And Jerex just not going for that. We're actually going to see the lift back. It looks like a time walk will come out. He's trying to actually ice shard for the last hit, but Fairy Fire is going to make it, push him over the edge, and he's going to be okay up top. But yeah, I actually think they could have gotten the puck there if they didn't pursue so heavily onto Jerex, but they wanted to contest the bounty rune. They wanted to go for the twofer, and if they had gotten both bounty runes and that second kill, then it would have been just amazing.
Right.
Even still, getting the kill, getting at least one bounty rune there. They're happy to start this off on the right foot.
Mind Control is being decently zoned back, it looks like. He's only level 2 and it's going to have to go back to his jungling. Cookies are making use of the neutrals pretty well. Steph Styles already hit his level 2. So it seems like Kezu is going to be able to get a bit more out of his lane for now. Obviously, things can really change, especially if Mind Control starts rotating around. The mid lane seems to be going pretty well for Fauna, and 8-2 rather. Kezu taking a bit more damage here. He really holds on to his time walk for a long time, and I think that especially with that level 1 cooldown, he knows that if he uses it early, he's just utterly shut out of the lane until it's back up.
Yeah, and it's just important because of how many potential disables they have against you. Like, you use it, they have so much follow through with the ice shards, with the snowball, and it's just dangerous. I don't think he goes down if he uses it a little early, but it's easy for, like you said, for them to shut him out of the lane and for Liquid to dominate that spot. Right now, at the very least, Void is actually coming in here against Fata, gets a bash, but Fata, of course, will get that gaunt away. It's good. Very, very interesting to see a faceless Void making such a rotation at this period of time.
Yeah, maybe if he had time dilation, I could understand that kind of gank a little bit more. Maybe Kezu just feels so much pressure in his lane that he just says, you know what, it's better for me to try and spend some time mid rather than going back to top lane and being chased out once again. At least he puts the idea of pressuring that mid lane there. You're going to see Jerix actually try and do something similar, it looks like, against the mid lane. This could be our first big rotation. In fact, they're going to go for the Courier first. 3 minutes in, it's going to be able to get an upgrade, and it's back up to full HP. Mind Control unable to snipe out the Courier.
Mm-hmm. Kezu up top now, just kind of seeing an opportunity to 1v1 against the Rubick. He's actually going to be putting up a decent bit of damage against him. He'll time walk some of that back the other way. So really good hit trading there, realizing that Tusk wasn't getting involved. And essentially, when Jerix and Kuro are both committed to the top lane, the Void can't really do too much. But obviously, that's not what the Tusk wants to do. He wants to roam. He wants to try to create opportunities, put out pressure. And while they didn't see the jump on the Invoker, It gave Kezu space, so just an overall, another small victory for Cookies, continue to move forward. But if we look at the last hits, that's where Liquid are dramatically favored.
Yeah, this is pretty surprising that Flens does not have as many last hits, or at least a little bit closer to the Lycan. That's a pretty big margin difference. He does have a totally free lane, so this isn't really that excusable. I'm not sure if how much pulling they did, and if he was having to last it under tower, that obviously definitely affect things. As
yeah,
Lycan is just easier to last general. He has better base damage, and he has wolves.
Yeah, 66 is pretty weak even at level 4. So I know there was at least one pull under tower, maybe a second one. That definitely would give some reasoning behind it, but still not great overall. It's going to be on Flynn's to pick the pace and to move forward towards some key items, because like you said, he's just got a massive shopping list. He's got to get so much for himself. I really don't think he's safe until he has both Battle Fury and Manta Style, and obviously that just takes a really long time to build up.
Yzgils has now managed to get himself a bit ahead of Fada's puck when it comes to CS. Spamming out the Ford Spirits and kind of throwing him at the puck is naturally going to win you the lane without some sort of outside help. Now, Jerix is thinking about providing that extra help, especially the way that Fada is harassing the Invoker so much. Misses that orb, though, and that kind of was required to bring the Invoker low enough for a kill, I think. Pablo, actually, his smoke is going to be popped. He lays down a ward. Doesn't look like Jerix actually saw him, and he lays down a ward of his own. That's going to be quickly scouted out by Cookies. See how quickly they're able to kind of ward it. Because right now, the other support is helping the Ember Spirit push out that bottom tier 1 tower.
Yeah, I find it interesting that Cookies is actually able to do a lot more damage to the bottom tier 1 than Liquid have to the top. I mean, they have a very clear lineup that's capable of just knocking the Void off the lane, going in. Obviously, they have to commit the Nature Prophet, but you will get a tier 1 up top in no time. But they seem to be more reserved and just focusing on farming the lane. Matoma Man really wants that Vlad's out as quickly as possible, and I mean, it's not giving them too much difficulty there, but at the same time, they're not dominating the map the way you'd expect.
Yeah, this really is the big difference between having an offlaner that stays in lane. Pablo is going to have to get down the cliff once again. He is going to be dream called up, but even if he dies here, this is almost kind of worth it. Liquid are spending so much time trying to kill him, they don't even get that much. Finally, it looks like Mind Control may be trying to do what you were talking about. The big difference between these two offlaners is that while Kezu can stay in lane constantly, Mind Control can actually roam to a tower, and as you say, push Kezu back, and that should allow them to take the tier 1. This team simply isn't ready to actually fight, especially without Chronosphere.
Yeah, he wants to try to like pull creeps back and stuff, but honestly, he's just gonna maybe get one time walk out of this, otherwise the tower is gone for sure. We're gonna see actually Rubick make his way down bottom too, Fade Bolting it, and although that's risky, if the Ember has Light, that's a potential kill. But in this case, it's just going to be him getting some free experience, getting a lot closer to his spell steal, and most importantly, keeping the tier 1 alive at 200 HP.
Spada is getting more and more aggressive at this mid lane. I keep watching him, and he does land a pretty good orb there. Doesn't choose to jump it, though, as he's a bit low on both mana and HP. But still, he's keeping the invoker scared. And he should be scared, too, because of the potential wraparound. They've taken that offlane tower. They could very easily rotate through the secret shop area and behind the tier 1. And, of course, Nature's Prophet as well with his global presence, soon to be amplified with the ultimate coming up. But Top of Man's looking trouble. For Pablo, but Pablo's just going to put himself on the cliff, I think. And he may be right-clicked down by Fada. Yeah, he will be.
Mm-hmm. Just roaming in the wrong part of town.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess the fact that that's their first death is something Cookies can be proud of, but it is just going to be that dire ward that not only saw the Winter Wyvern when he initially smoked for that ward, but also pushes him out now and actually is able to claim his life. We're going to be seeing Chronosphere come out pretty soon here. What do you think about these ultimates? Like, I feel like the game changes in a very significant way when heroes start hitting level 6, but who is actually more favored? I think Cookies have a lot to bring to the table, but their Wyvern is only 3, so it's going to be a late one from him.
I think that it's definitely Cookies who becomes stronger with their level 6, but as you really pointed out, it's the supports being underleveled is going to cause them the biggest issue. Fortunately, they've got the basic combo right now, which is the Disruptor ult, paired up with the Chronosphere. That is going to be the best part of the combination. The Winter's Wyvern's, like, Winter's Curse, I feel, especially since change, is more like a cherry on top, right? It's not something that you really rely on too much. Maybe sometimes it sets up a good fight, or it allows you to disengage or something like that, or maybe you get a pick off on someone because of it, but I think as a whole, it's not an ultimate that you're really relying on as much as you use anyway.
Yeah. Unfortunate from Liquid, I think Mind Control just straight up missed a kill. The Faceless Void was farming the camp under the Observer Ward around the Secret Shop. It was down at 100 HP, and that was easily a Wrath of Nature kill, just straight up, but doesn't keep an eye on the minimap well enough to see that opportunity. They focus on themselves, get their tower deny, which of course is the most important part of that bottom lane. But yeah, another kill would have been great for Furion.
Kuro is halfway to his level 6, and he does have a smoke coming up. Arcane boots being picked up by Steph Style already. This Disruptor's farm is pretty impressive. Actually,
yeah.
He's purely off of neutrals. Nice pick off there from Mind Control, the Howl, allowing the Furion to very easily right-click down the Courier.
Gonna do much more in terms of invasion, though, and I feel like this is the time where Liquid start ramping up the pressure in their own ways. So yeah, we do see the smoke coming through. It looks like it's a coordinated gank. They want to get Pata involved. If he can get a kill or an assist here, he will be having enough gold for his blink, and then suddenly the Ember has to be very, very afraid. So I think it's overall a great initiation, and we're gonna see it on mid.
Yeah, Pablo, once again, is going to be the target here. He managed to get off his good Cold Embrace that will buy him a bit of time, but he's pretty much dead. Now the question is, are they going to be able to get much else out of this? Walrus Punch, still not enough to finish off Pablo. Now they've got the ultimate coming out. Jarek's going to be stuck underneath that one. The extra Static Storm probably would have needed, and because of that, they're able to get the two supports. Kezu's going to have to jump himself away, and uh-oh, that's going to be pretty dangerous here. Kuro can actually get the right jump. Lens just barely managed to stay ahead there of the Lycan and gets a jump out before a crit could finish him off, but Kuro's going to be able to hold on to that Chronosphere, and that is a big stake by Kezu.
Yeah, very unfortunate there, but we are going to be seeing now Kuro hanging on to that one, and I mean, while he doesn't find like an Invoker and Invis with it, he's still just able to hang on to that for the next fight. This is guaranteed Roche if that's what they want. I mean, any objective is really guaranteed. When you don't have Chrono to worry about, you don't have Static Storm to worry about, and you have Chrono on your side, suddenly you create so much value. And while we were both on the same page that Cookies had the better teamfight ultimates, one of those ultimates is now in the hands of the Rubick, so I feel like that has dramatically changed how Cookies have to play the next few minutes.
Sunstrike checking for Roshan, seeing if whether or not Liquid have rotated over there. Pick that off. Going back to that fight though, Was that just me, or was that a really bad Static Storm? Like, that was laid on a dead Tusk, pretty much. Maybe it prevents him from snowballing as soon as the Chronosphere is down, but using two big-time ultimates like that for, you know, a four-position Tusk pretty much means you're never going to fight like that. You have to use that Static Storm to control the puck.
Absolutely. I 100% agree with you there, and it just seemed like he didn't have a really good read on what was going on. Obviously, that was a smoke jump, so maybe they were kind of in panic mode. They were just trying to react to the situation, but yeah, that was definitely a misuse of the ultimate, and cost them quite dramatically, as now, even though Liquid just kind of slow-rolled that fight, they still took his loss dramatically, and Liquid are starting to bring this entire stage of the game back. We'll see. I think it should still be a Roche move. Again, they have this Chronosphere, like, and just finished off the bottom tier 1. Like, this is a great opportunity to move into Roche.
Yeah, certainly. There's, like, once you've taken the mid and safe lane tower away from the Radiant, they lose so much control over that Roche on pit. It's already pretty tough for Radiant anyway. So this is a pretty natural trade-off. I think Cookies at this point in time know that they are unlikely to be able to contest Roshan very well, so they probably know what's going on right now, and they're just willing to make the trade-off of a tier 1 tower for it. But this is probably going to be Liquid are going to rotate straight to the bottom lane and take that tier 2 as well.
Alrighty, so we've got ourselves an Aegis and now a Necronomicon on Matumbo Man. That's going to be allowing him to do a hell of a lot more work in terms of the push. But the real question I have is, do they get tier 3s off of this? Do they actually break high ground and look at Rax? I mean, Kuro's Chronosphere is about to expire. Kokas have all their teamfight ultimates back up, and most of them apply to AoE. They are really good at fighting at choke points. And unless Vata, like, suddenly just sets up a quick pick, like Blink, Waning Rift, Dream Coil kill, I feel like Cookies are going to have the upper hand just in terms of draft.
I think Liquid should push Phil right now, but solely to be able to force Cookies back from that tier 2 tower. They don't want to be fighting, they don't want to be TPing into a situation like that because of the way Chronosphere sets up. So you'd much rather be the ones forcing Cookies back, but I don't know if they really want to take a full fight here. It looks like they're still sticking around, but in my opinion, they should definitely wait for Necrobook 3 just to make it an easier push. But they're going to jump in, get a good silence there on Flens. The glimpse back, though, poorly timed, and that's only going to send him back to his blink position. This is also another thing. Pushing into a Winter Wyvern is incredibly tough. In fact, they're relying on it so much that Kezu is still freely pushing out that top lane, knowing that Liquid can't really go into a Winter Wyvern very easily.
The Radiant Observer Ward south of Kezu is very important because it's a crawl. Oh, just keep on seeing those jumps. Just like Vata.
Oh, what? I really thought for sure that Pablo was going to go for Winter's Curse. Maybe now? No, they've got the Static Storm on Vata. He's definitely dead here. Now they can still Static Storm up something with the Puck dead. Looks like in the background, Pablo is going to be chased down by the Wolves. They got to help him out. And that leaves Matumbo Man on the front lines now that all these heroes are pushed away to get some damage onto the Tier 3 tower. But they really need to catch a little bit more here if they want to be able to make a comeback in this game. A Puck kill was nice, but it's not enough to really offset the flow of this game. And unfortunately, Cookies never managed to find that. Neither Chronosphere nor Winter's Curse.
So, like I was saying up top, the Observer Ward there for the Void, it's actually a really big deal, because otherwise the Tusk could just stay out of vision, TP back, and go for a Snowball play to prevent the Void from hitting. The Chrono is way more important than anything the Tusk can throw out, so at that point, if you can cancel the TP on the Void, you automatically win the high ground fight on bottom. But they had a ward behind him, he was confident, and the Tusk doesn't actually go for that play. So, in the end, Cookies with a great pickup on the Puck, while Stepsaw has had a few questionable plays, that combo on the Puck was perfect, and they hold it. Like you said, they still want more, but just that first assault being held off and the Battle Fury getting that much closer for Flens, like, that's still their game plan. It just really comes down to getting that Battle Fury so you can deal with the Necro, so you can deal with the Wolves. Yeah, Liquid are going to be getting stronger. They've got the Necro 2 coming out and the Aether Lens for Kuro as well. These are good items, but unless they use this Aegis in the next 2 minutes, I still actually think these are more happy with the fact that they get to drag this out further.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they're pretty close to getting that Battle Fury. The most expensive items are being picked up right now by Flens, both the Broadsword as well as the Claymore. They're actually going to go for a 4-man smoke here, have Ezu push out that mid lane even further. He's trying to complete his Vlads. Now, they're either going to treat him as bait or they're going to rotate up to the top lane. It looks like bait it is. Team Liquid might just take this bait too. They've already seen Kuro. They don't necessarily want Matumbo Man. That's not going to be the best hero to jump on with that Aegis. Uh-huh. They could get a critical support, that would be better. Or Fada would be perfect.
Yeah, but obviously. That would be the ideal, but It's tough. It really is. And it looks like they're not even going to go for it. They're so unconfident about the current formation against Liquid. I think they're being baited into a five-man trap.
Yeah, so they back themselves away. Now it's going to be Liquid pushing down another tier two with this Aegis still in hand.
Go mid.
Silence. A quick jump. Yeah, Dream Coil, and it's not going to be enough time for him to be able to time walk out of that one. Meanwhile, in the top lane, Jerix is going to be the target. Looks like he should be going down as he's going to be glimpsed back. He tries to go for the quick kill on Pablo, but there is a heal first. The orb coming out from Bada will be able to eliminate both that support as well as help kill the Disruptor. And farther down, it's going to be Eskil chased away by Matumbaban. He makes a quick little U-turn back to the tier 2 in middle lane while his team takes out the top tier 2.
Great punish from Liquid. They just recognize the fact that Kukis are trying to say, okay, well, let's push out all our lanes, let's put the map, and let's try to make sure we keep all our towers alive. And by doing that, they're making a greedy play because they can easily just be isolated. Divide and Conquer comes out from Liquid. They make the quick jump on the Void, combo him up, and as squishy as he is with the Silence opener, it's like killing a Weaver. It's just about getting that quick burst, and they do it well. And from there, with no Void, they're guaranteed the fight up top, and they punish that as well. So across the board, Liquid really just had a great game plan going into those two skirmishes. And that gives them every outer tier 2 tower.
Necrobook 3, Orchid, a Yule Scepter now on the puck as well.
The Yule is huge, by the way.
Yeah.
If you can Yule during the Static Storm, right before the Chronosphere, anything of that nature, you're going to be able to do so much more in the teamfight as the puck. So it's absolutely essential that he picks that up at a good timing for their next siege, and it will completely negate what we saw in the last fight, which was him getting punished by the glimpse.
Jump away, 6-7, about 20 minutes in, 10k lead right now for Team Liquid. Obviously not nearly the same kind of experience lead, only about 3,500, and that's purely due to the fact that this is all tower gold that they've been ranking in. I do like the fact that Kukis have managed to at least push two of the outer tier 1 towers, but in this sort of game, against this sort of pushing team, you gotta find some sort of opening, take at least a tier 2. Otherwise, you're just gonna naturally run out of bolts. The enemy team's just gonna be so far ahead in net worth, and perhaps that really comes down to the choice of carry. If they had something like a Juggernaut that actually has a lot better pushing power. Bottom lane looks like they're gonna be able to catch out the Ember Spirit. This is both the Silence from the puck as well as Orchid. The Orchid's gonna pop, and he manages. Oh, jeez, just
hit.
Barely jump over.
One hit from death, that is just a brutal loss for Liquid. They were smoking up, they were ready to not only get that kill with the double silence, but then follow it up with anybody in the vicinity, but they get absolutely nothing there. They're just going to go for the high ground, but now the Ember Spirit can sell one item and get his Battle Fury, and they can actually make this defense, or at least attempt it.
Sword's pretty interesting. Ice Shards goes out. Waiting for the creeps to go away to see exactly what kind of, because I'm presuming it's just like a cone like this.
Yeah, it's like pretty thin. It's like right, you see at the tier 3 tower base, I believe, but the smoke makes that even less effective. The wolves, I think, saw the smoke, but I think Liquid have to be very careful how they position, or Kuro just gets picked immediately.
The wraparound here. Ezra's gonna jump in, Chronosphere is gone! The Orchid comes out first, now the Static Storm is gonna be laid down, but it's already too late. The initiation has failed, the Snowball is gonna go out, being able to save Kuro out. They will be able to get a Time Walk away as well on the left-hand side. Matumbaman's going for the big carries, he's already taken out the Invoker, and now it's gonna be controlled up by Pablo, but the minions are gonna do their work, they're gonna run down Pablo in return. Now Matumbaman, he's got no way out of this one, there's a Chronosphere on the way. Still though, the Orchid gets laid out, they just lack damage now. Kukis may lose E-skills a secondary time, he gets called up, he gets taken out as well, and now Kukis are blowing every single buyback they can, but they've already lost the lane of Rax anyway. This pretty much ensures there is no hope here for Kukis in coming back into the game. They've just blown too much of their net worth fruitlessly. They have to get some sort of good fight, but it just doesn't seem to happen. Kez is going to be dying here due to the Orchid pop, and even Flint is going to have to jump back to the fountain. It's Steph now who goes down instead. Something like a 7-for-nothing trade-off. Something absurd.
Yeah, insane with the multiple buybacks there, but the most important thing is just how that breach went for Liquid. If that breach fails, then Kukis are at least even in this game, but the big thing is that silence on the Chronosphere. That would have been at least a 4-man Chronosphere. easy jump, easy follow through from Cook is. They could have gotten so much done in that timing window, but the silence, the quick orchid from the Furion negates it entirely, and suddenly everything goes Liquid's way. They're able to actually put the Puck and the Lycan on the front lines, do massive damage to the supports who didn't want to get caught, and Liquid take this handedly. I mean, like, now we have buyback and cooldown for both the Void and the Invoker. They're completely in the hole. They've lost their bottom racks entirely, and Liquid are very confident from this point forward. I honestly feel like majority of the momentum of this game was decided by that fight alone.
A 20,000 gold lead by 22 minutes in. That's what happens when you lose a fight, buyback, and still continue to lose the fight, plus the lane of racks. Cookies, I mean, we talked about how the Battle Fury isn't going to be enough by itself, and with the buyout earlier from Flens, plus almost a pickoff, but just the fact that he's never really been able to actually sit in lane and farm up too much, he's just not going to have that Daedalus fast enough. They should be able to pick up then the next Roshan, turn that Aegis into another lane of racks. At that point in time, two lanes of racks down by at least, 27, 28 minutes? You're very unlikely to come back, man.
Kind of find it quite curious, though, that... Oh, well, while Ruby gets the last hit there.
A lot of burst damage.
Just does a little bit of damage. Oh, look at this! Just a three right clicks, nearly kills the support.
They will manage to get a good deafening blast. They still manage to kill the Disruptor, and now the Snowball save, or at least attempted save, it's not even needed. Fana managed to get himself out. E-Skills almost goes down. They had to use the Winter's Curse to be able to save him. Jerix will get out just fine. And Flens showing himself now, but maybe Jerix, just a little bit more damage. You can't really commit there in order to finish him off. In the back did get silenced up, and Flens is still looking for that pickoff somewhere, but once again, they just lack the kind of staying power. It's the problem with Ember Spirit and Faceless Void on the same team, is that they both seriously lack damage in this 20-minute marker point in time. Like, this is about the time that the Ember Spirit's magic damage is no longer as reliable, and Faceless Void is still lacking physical damage and also doesn't offer nearly enough utility.
Yeah, it's not like the Disruptor and the Winter Weaver are necessarily making up for it. Yeah, they bring some damage with things like Splinter Blast, and the last few ticks of the Static Storm certainly hurt. But for the most part, these are supports that lack damage output, and finding those kills are going to be very difficult. And I think that's why Mind Control is actually incentivized to pick up a mechanism to kind of even greater punish the fact that there is no kill potential. But when your Puck is picking up a Veil of Discord, and you're trying to also enhance your magical damage, I would actually like to see a Dagon on that Nature's Prophet. Just by mindset, if you get that Orchid, Dagon, Veil action going, you get an easy pick, and you, with buybacks on cooldown, you guarantee the game. But no matter what, they've got a lot of tankiness now. A Heart, a Mech, they're good to go.
Yeah, Matumba Man can sit on the front lines all day and all night at this point in time. In bottom lane, trying to block out, just get a little bit of harassment damage. He will be glimpsed back into play, but missed out the kinetic field, and Jerix can walk himself out. But he still has the snowball anyway. In fact, they're going to try and go for E-Skills here. They do have the counter ward laid out. They pick him off 50 seconds down on the clock. Bada jumps forward for more. They manage to silence up. Kezu won't be able to finish him off, though. They got to be careful now, as with Kezu back up, might be able to get some sort of Chronosphere, but they gotta force the fight at bottom. Otherwise, they're gonna lose their whole entire mid lane of racks and still have Matumba Man back into the fight at bottom lane. They throw out a little bit more harassment damage, but Matumba Man's already looking for Megas at the time. The snowball comes forward, they get Seth's out as well as Kezu. The Cold Embrace gets laid out, but Kezu doesn't really need that one. In fact, he just sets him up for a Telekinesis into Orchid. That will be the game. Cookies will lose against Team Liquid, who maintain a very clean 10-1 record here on the We Play EU West.
So, another relatively quick game from WePlay, but I feel like this game had a lot of depth to it. There was a lot of potential for Cookies to bring it back. That comeback goal was so close they could taste it, but I feel like Liquid just played crisp. They knew that their weaknesses, they were able to play around it. The divide and conquer play they made for the tier 2s was really strong. The execution there from the Nature's Prophet, definitely the play of the game, just that silence. I mean, he's